Hi, I'm Andrew Strome, and welcome to the first in a series of essential glues for the woodworker. Today I'm going to be talking to you about PVAs, animal glues, and polyurethanes. We'll cover epoxies and CAs separately later. One of the first questions that gets asked about gluing is, which is the best to use? And it depends. It depends on what materials you're gluing. It depends on what your project is and what environment it'll be subjected to and what properties of a particular glue are important to you. The first family of glues I'm going to talk about is PVAs, and PVA is short for polyvinyl acetate. So as the name suggests, these glues are an emulsion of plastic in water, just like very similar to latex paint. They've got a lot of properties that are useful for woodworking. So they're one part, you don't have to mix up separate components. They clean up easily with water, and they have a reasonable dry time, about 24 hours at room temperature. The first glue I'm gonna discuss is an aliphatic resin, and it's called 2002 GF. And this is a really good glue for interior projects. So the GF stands for gap filling. It's got a very high solids content. And what that means is that if there happens to be some gaps in the joinery, the glue will help occupy those spaces. You can see that it's a light brown color in the container. And so it dries to that color, which means that the cured glue line is pretty inconspicuous, and yet if some happens to accidentally get smeared on the workpiece, it's also easy to pick up. This particular glue is Type Bond 3, and the manufacturer has added a catalyst to it so that the glue molecules, which normally cure in long strands, actually link to each other. That's called cross-linking. And what that does is it gives the glue a lot of additional resistance to moisture and heat. So that makes this glue a really good choice for things like exterior projects, but also projects that are going to be exposed intermittently to moisture, like a cutting board, or have moderate exposure to heat, like a cutting board or a serving board. PVAs are tremendously useful, but there are a few watch-outs to be aware of. One is that because they're an emulsion, just like paint, if they've been sitting for any time, the contents will settle, and so it needs to be stirred. The other is that they do have a shelf life. So if your glue happens to be old, it'll come out, it'll be very thick, and really have almost no watery consistency to it at all. Toss it, get some new glue. New glue is cheap insurance. The other thing to be aware of, most of us have experienced this, but it's worth pointing out, is that PVAs, when they cure, form a sort of a sealer almost on the surface of the wood. And many of us have had this happen where, this is a little bit of a dramatic demonstration, but I've got some PVA dried here. And if I apply this oil finish, as it soaks into the wood, you'll see that where the PVA is, where it's dried, isn't absorbing the finish. So it's really important when you're cleaning up squeeze out to make sure that you've gotten rid of all of it. The other thing to be aware of with PVAs is that they are temperature sensitive. So they have what's known as a chalk temperature. And that's around 10 degrees Celsius, 50 degrees Fahrenheit. It varies depending on the formulation. But below that temperature, they won't cure properly. And so I've got a sample here that was glued up in cold conditions. And I'm just gonna quickly split it apart. But you can see how easily that opened up. So in this case, the glue has failed rather than the wood. Any of the glues that we use in woodworking are typically stronger than the wood itself. And I can tell just by the texture here, if I scrape with my fingernail, I can actually scrape the residual glue off. And so this is a good indication of what happens when you try to work with PVA and either the shop or the wood or both are too cold. So there you have it, PVA glues, probably the most familiar family of woodworking adhesives, but like anything, they do have their limitations and things to watch out for. The next family to talk about are animal glues. These are probably our oldest glues for woodworking, and they fell out of favor about 50 years ago as synthetic glues were introduced. But they've undergone a resurgence lately as woodworkers, modern woodworkers, discover their distinct advantages. So they are reversible with heat and moisture, so that's an important consideration if you're building something like musical instruments, as an example. They are easy to clean up in terms of removing squeeze out. And lastly, they're very easy to repair. First glue I'm going to show you is fish glue. And fish glue is derived from the skins of fish like cod and haddock. And it's little known, but it's tremendously useful and versatile. So you can use it to bond dissimilar materials as long as one of them is porous. So you can adhere metal to wood. So it's tremendously versatile. It tacks up very quickly, but at the same time it has what's called a long open time. So that makes it really useful for assembling complex projects. The other thing that's nice about it is that it's not nearly as sensitive to cold temperatures as something like a PVA is. The other animal glue to talk about is liquid hide glue. This is hide glue in its raw form. So it's hide glue is simply the trimmings and tendons of the animal that have been processed to hydrolyze the protein and create these granules. Liquid hide glue is the same as glue that you would prepare yourself, except that it's had some urea added to it so that it maintains a liquid state. When working with it though, it's really important to, it'll flow out much more easily if you just put it in a bath of warm water. Warming the glue up helps ensure that it doesn't gel too quickly. When the glue gels, it becomes very difficult to work with and less effective as an adhesive, so warming it up helps prolong the working time. One of the real advantages of hide glue is that it's not impervious to finishes. And in fact, an old recipe for making a pre-stained conditioner to even out the absorption of a particularly blotchy wood like cherry or pine is to coat it in a very dilute solution of hide glue. I've got an area of this board and I've got some hide glue smeared on it, and I'm just going to apply a little bit of oil to it. And you'll see how the glue pretty much disappears under the finish in contrast with the PVA. So one of the great advantages of animal glues and hide glue in particular is that any squeeze out is relatively straightforward to contend with. So I'm just going to take a toothbrush and some warm water, and I'm going to take my cloth. And there was quite a bit of squeeze out in that area, just for the sake of demonstration. And you can see that just that initial application and a bit of scrubbing has contended with a lot of it. And if I was to do that again, And then rub it with my cloth. Just in this little area that I've been working on, it's pretty much gone. And then of course, hide glue's ability to absorb finish helps us even more when we go to finish a piece. So one of the real benefits of animal glues, no poking around with the chisel or potentially with a shoulder plane and gouging the work, simply a toothbrush, some warm water, and a cloth. There you have it, animal glues, a tremendously versatile addition to your arsenal. Lots of features to recommend them, not the least of which is their ability to take finish. The polyurethane glues are a relatively recent addition to the arsenal of woodworking glues, like within the last 30 years or so. They're related to other polyurethanes you might be familiar with, like varnishes as an example, where varnishes cure to form a finish film. Polyurethane adhesive cures to form a glue line. Polyurethanes work really well for gluing dissimilar materials together, things like wood to metal, as an example. They're very good for lamination work because the glue line is very rigid, so something like a rocking chair, as an example. The other area they excel are things like exotic woods, woods that tend to have a high oil content. Those are notoriously difficult to glue successfully, and polyurethanes really excel at those. Few things to be aware of with polyurethanes, however. One is that they cure via chemical reaction, and water is the catalyst for that chemical reaction. So in a dry environment, a dry, you know, winter basement or a dry summer day, it can actually be very helpful to just give the surface of the wood a light spritz with water to help get that chemical reaction started. And one of the advantages of polyurethane, actually, if you're familiar with the spray foam, you'll know that the cured foam is actually quite weak. So as a result, the squeeze out from polyurethane is very easy to remove. However, one of its attributes is that it really has no gap filling ability to speak of. So good wood to wood contact is really critical. I've got a piece that I've glued up, the glue has cured, and this is simply a dowel inserted into a very slightly oversized hole, like less than a 1/16 of an inch or so. So I've applied an excessive amount of glue. You can see all the squeeze out here. But if I just give this a wiggle, you can see just how easily that comes out because the foam has no strength. Were this a cured glue line, I would not have been able to disassemble those two parts. One more thing to mention, is that polyurethanes are totally waterproof. So that makes them really good for exterior projects, but also for marine use below the waterline. And there you have it. That was a quick look at three of the most essential and commonly used glues for woodworking. Thanks very much for joining us, and we'll see you next time.